King Edward VI College, Centre Number 20570, Theatre Studies, Unit 2, performance of Maret, Sade. My name is Luce Cavell-Locke, my candidate number is 6173, and I play the Herald.
My name is Nigel de Corbett, my candidate number is 6021, and I play Dupre.
My name is Sarah Horton, my candidate number is 6455, and I play Corday.
My name is Laura Waldridge, my candidate number is 7051, and I play Simone Lamard.
My name is Christopher Coe, my candidate number is 6202, and I play Camille.
My name is Edward Rigby, my candidate number is 6809, and I am playing Jean-Paul Maret.
My name is John Tranta, my candidate number is 6979, and I play Jacques Roux.
My name is Tobias Edwards, my candidate number is 7124, and I play the Marquis de Sade.
We prefer therapy through education and especially art, so that our hospital may place part faithfully following, according to our light, the Declaration of Human Rights. I agree with our author, Monsieur Cassard. This is placed set in our modern bathhouse won't be marred by all these instruments for mental and physical hygiene. Quite on the contrary, these set the scene. For in Monsieur Cassard's play, he's trying to show how Jean-Paul Maret died and how he waited in that bath before Charlotte Corday came knocking at his door.
Already seated in his place, here is Maret. Observe his face. 15 years old, not yet dead. He wears a bandage around his head. His flesh burns. It is yellow as cheese. It is disfigured by a skin disease. And only water cooling every limb prevents his fever. To act this most important role, we chose a lucky paranoid, one of those who made unprecedented strides since we introduced them to hydrotherapy. Now, the lady who's acting as his nurse, whose touch certainly makes him no worse, is Simone Lavard, not Charlotte Corday. Maret and Lavard united one day. They share one vision of the just and true, and also shared her money too. Here's Charlotte Corday waiting for her entry. She comes from Cayenne. Her family landed gentry. Her dress is pretty, shoes chic, and you'll note, she readjusts the cloth around her throat. Historians agree, so it's not new to us to say she's phenomenally pulchritudinous. Unfortunately, the girl who plays the role here has sleeping sickness, also melancholia. Our hope must be for this afflicted soul that she does not forget her role. No! Here's Monsieur Dupre, with silken hose and fresh toupee, to the revolution's murderous insanity. He brings a touch of high urbanity. Though, as a well-known geologist, his name's upon Marat's blacklist. He's handsome, cheerful, full of zest. Needs more watching than the rest. Jail for taking a radical view of anything. You can name the former priest, Jacques Roux, ally of Maret's revolution, but Unfortunately, the censors cut most of his rousing theme. Our moral guardians found it too extreme.
Liberty!
Ladies and gentlemen, our players are drawn from all social layers now. Take this man from high society, who under the lurid star of notoriety came to live with us just 5 years ago. It's to his genius we owe our show. The former Marquis, Monsieur Tassard, whose books were banned, his essays barred while he was persecuted and reviled, thrown into jail and, for some years, exiled. The introduction's over now. The play of Jean-Paul Maret can get underway tonight. The date is the 13th of July, 1808. And on this night, our cast intends showing you how 15 years ago, like without end fell on that night.
And now I'm
Simone! More cold water! Change my hand, Nick! Oh, this itching is unbearable!
Jean-Paul, don't scratch yourself. You'll tear your skin to shreds. Give up writing, Jean-Paul. It won't do any good.
My call! My 4th of July call! To the people of France!
Heaps with eyes and mouths. What kind of town is this, hacked by
Now it's happening. And you can't stop it happening. The people used to suffer everything. Now they take their revenge. You were watching that revenge, but you don't remember what drove the people to it. Now you protest, but it's too late to start crying over spilt blood. What is the blood of these aristocrats compared to the blood that people shed for you? Many of them had their throats slit by your gangs. Many of them died more slowly in your workshops. So what are a few looted mansions compared with their looted lives? You don't care if the foreign armies with whom you've made secret deals march in and massacre the people. You hope they are wiped out so that you can flourish. And when they are wiped out, not a muscle will twitch in your puffy bourgeois faces, which are now all twisted up with anger and disgust.
We show only these people massacred because this indisputably occurred. Please, calmly watch these barbarous displays, which cannot happen nowadays. The men of that time, mostly now demised, were primitive. We are more civilized.
I read in your books, De Star, in one of your immortal works, that the animating force of nature is destruction, and the only way of measuring life is death.
Correct, Maret. But man has given a false importance to death. Every animal, plant or man who dies adds to nature's compost heap, becomes the manure without which nothing can grow, nothing can be created. Death is simply a part of the process. Every death, even the cruelest death, drowns in the total indifference of nature. Nature herself would watch and move if we destroyed the entire human race. I hate nature. This passionless spectator. This unbreakable iceberg face that can bear everything. That goads us to greater and greater acts. But even though I hate this goddess, I can see that the greatest acts in history have followed her laws. Nature tells a man to fight for his own survival. And if he must kill to gain it, why then, the murder is natural. We must reproduce. We must destroy. The balance must be kept. Haven't we always beaten down those weaker than ourselves? Haven't we always torn at their throats with continuous villainy and lust? Haven't we always experimented in our laboratories before applying the final solution? Man is a destroyer. But if he must kill to gain it, then he is a machine. He must destroy with passion like a man. Let me remind you of the execution of Damien's after his unsuccessful attempt to assassinate Louis XV. How gentle the guillotine is compared with his torture. 4 hours it lasted while the crowd goggled and Casanova at an upper window felt under the skirts of the ladies watching. They slit open his chest, arms, thighs, and calves. Molten lead was poured into each slit. Boiling oil they poured over him. Burning wax, tar, sulfur. They burnt off his hands. Tied ropes to his arms and legs. Harnessed 4 horses to him and geared them up. They pulled at him for an hour. They'd never done it before, and he wouldn't come apart until they soared through his shoulders and hips. He lost the first arm, and then the second. And he turned to us and shouted so we could all understand. And they tore off the first leg, and then the second leg. He still lived, though his voice was getting weak. He just hung there, a bloody torso with a nodding head. Just groaning, staring at the crucifix, which the father confessor was holding up to him. That was a festival with which today's festivals can't compete. Even our inquisitions have no meaning anymore. post-revolutionary murders are all official. We condemn to death without emotion. And there's no personal debt to be had, only an anonymous chieftain's debt with which we can dole out to entire nations on a mathematical basis until a time comes for all life to be extinguished.
Citizen Marquis, you may have fought for us last September when we dragged out the gals of the aristocrats who plotted against us, but you still talk like a grand seigneur. And what you call the animating force of nature is your own lack of compassion.
Ha! Now, Maret, you're talking like an aristocrat. Compassion is the property of the ruling classes. When the pitier lowers himself to a beggar, he throbs with contempt. To protect his riches, he pretends to be moved, and his gift to the beggar amounts to no more than a kick. No, Maret, no small emotions, please. For you, just as for me, only the most extreme actions matter.
If I'm extreme, I must extreme in the same way as you. Against the king's wishes, I take action. In the vast indifference, I invent a meaning and say that this and this are wrong. The important thing is to drag yourself up by your own hair, to turn your skin inside out, and to see the whole world with fresh eyes.
Maret's liturgy.
Remember how it used to be? The kings were our dear fathers under whose care we lived in peace. Piously, the simple-minded breadwinners passed on this message to their children. But then the priests chained down the poor with their ignorance so that they could not stand up to their bosses, who were all locked down by the priests.
We agree to make some cuts in this passage. After all, don't we now object to the church? Not now when there's any question of anyone being addressed. In fact, everything is done to relieve suffering. In fact, in this very clinic, we're dependent not only on our temporal government, but also with an understanding of the church.
If our performance causes aggravation, we hope you'll swallow down your indignation. Please remember that we show only those things which happened long ago. Things were very different then, of course. Today, we're all God-fearing men. Pray.
Oh, pray to him.
Pray.
Our Satan, which art in hell, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth.
Yes.
As it is in hell. Forgive us our good deeds and deliver us from holiness. Lead us into temptation.
Into
temptation.
Over and over.
Amen.
This unfortunate incident you've just seen was unavoidable. Indeed, foreseen by our playwright, who managed to compose better lines against either of us. Please remember that this woman was once the very well thought of matron of a nunnery. It must remind us all that, as they say, God moves like man in a mysterious way.
Before we can decide what is wrong and what is right, first we must find out who we are. I do not know myself. No sooner have I discovered something than I begin to doubt it and must destroy it again. What we do is just a shadow of what we want to do. And the only truths we can point to are the ever-changing truths of our own existence. I do not know whether I am a hangman or victim. For I imagine the most horrible tortures, and as I describe them, I suffer them myself. There's nothing I can't do, and everything fills me with horror, and I can see that others too turn themselves into strangers and are driven to unpredictable acts. A little while ago, I saw my tailor, a short, cultured man who liked to talk of philosophy. I saw him foam at the mouth, and screaming and raging, attack with a cudgel a man from Switzerland. A large man, heavily armed, and destroyed utterly. Then I saw him tear open the breast of the defeated man. Saw him take out the still beating heart and swallow it. A mad man. Man's a mad animal. I've been alive 1,000 years. I've helped to commit 1,000,000 murders. The earth is spread. The earth is spread thick with squashed human guts. We few survivors walk among a quaking bog of corpses, always under.